married for the express person that they think they have found the person that's going to, quote, make them happy. And there are three facts I would share with you. First of all, the fact number one is you may be married to as good a person as there is. You may be married to a godly person, a kind person, a serving person. They're not perfect, but all the pieces are there. But if you are not spiritually contented, then you are not going to be happy in marriage. That's the first fact. You may be married to a good person, but without spiritual contentment, that person cannot in and of themselves make you happy. Secondly, you may be facing the normal challenges that everyone faces in marriage. The normal challenges. But if you yourself don't possess spiritual contentment, you will tend to view those normal challenges in marriage as a reason to get out of your marriage. You'll think, well, I'm not happy, I'm not contented, I must have married the wrong person, when in reality, the problem is not outside of you, the problem is within you. Here's the third fact. In God's eyes, the person you marry becomes the right person the moment you take those vows. If I hear one more time, well, I just fell out of love. Brother, sister, once you take those vows, God says love that person. God says stay in the relationship. God says serve them. God says find out what real love is all about. The Bible says God hates divorce. Now, the Bible does not say that God hates divorced people. Probably everyone in here has been touched by divorce in some way. So the Bible does not say God hates divorced people. The Bible does not say that God throws divorced people under the bus. There's room at the cross for those who've been divorced. I understand that. I preach that. But the problem in our society is that by and large, people take their vows far too lightly. They end marriages not because they have a biblical reason to end them, not because there's adultery, not because there's abuse or abandonment. They end marriages because they're just tired of trying. And they mistakenly think somebody out there can make them happy. And they blame their spouse for their lack of happiness. They blame their spouse for their lack of contentment. And when their lack of happiness, when their lack of contentment oftentimes says 1,000 more times about their spiritual condition than it says anything about their spouse. You see, happiness and contentment is a spiritual issue. People all over the world seek happiness and contentment in things like money and possessions. Y'all know that. People all over the world seek happiness and contentment in experiences and in people. All the while, happiness and contentment always has been spiritual in nature. One reason the divorce rate is so high is simply that people trade in their spouses on new ones in mistaken belief that they're going to find somebody to make them happy. The truth is, until you and I are right with God, until you and I are spiritually complete, no relationship, no amount of money, no achievement will be able to fill that void in our lives. Not long ago, Laura and I were in Tampa, and I got to play golf on a nice golf course. And there was a home on the golf course that was 20,000 square feet. The living room in the home, I looked it up on Zillow, the living room in the home is bigger than the house we live in. Why do you build a 20,000 square foot home? You build a 20,000 square foot home because a 4,000 square foot home wasn't enough. Then you build a 10,000 square foot home because the 4,000 square foot one wasn't enough. You end up with a 21,000 square foot home. The fact of the matter is, without spiritual contentment that flows out of a healthy relationship to Jesus Christ, a 21,000 square foot home with 10 cars in the garage will not satisfy your soul. Likewise, until you're right with God, growing in your faith, you could be married to the most wonderful woman or man on earth and still be dissatisfied most of the time. And I'm going to quote a passage of Scripture here, Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me.
And people say, oh, I love that verse. That tells me that God gives me strength to face anything. And yes, it's applicable there. But here's the truth. That verse in the context has to do with spiritual contentment. Verses 12, 11 and 12 say this, not that I speak from want, for I've learned to be content in whatever circumstances I am. I know how to get along with humble means, and I also know how to live in prosperity. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of being filled and going hungry, both of having abundance and suffering need. Then, Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Apostle Paul says he has learned to be content. In other words, that contentment and happiness is a spiritual secret, a spiritual quality. He said it was a secret that he had learned. His ability to experience happiness and contentment was directly related to his relationship to Jesus Christ. How does that apply to marriage? Well, it applies like this. Your ability to enjoy your spouse for who they are, with their strengths, with their various imperfections, is directly dependent upon whether or not you have an inner spiritual contentment in place. And I will say that again. The Bible teaches that you will not be happy in life, you will not be happy with yourself, you will not be happy in marriage until you recognize that happiness and contentment are spiritual qualities that develop from within you. You might say, well, Brother Tommy, are you saying that all a person has to do is be spiritually healthy and they'll be happy in marriage no matter how their spouse treats them? No, that's not what I'm saying at all. There are spouses who are unfaithful. They will answer for that. There are men and women who break up marriages. They will have to answer to God for that. There are spouses who abandon their spouses. There are spouses who break their vows through abuse. What I'm saying is, I'm not saying there's never a biblical reason to dissolve a marriage, but what I am saying is, until you and I get a spiritual component in place, long-term, consistent happiness and contentment is beyond our grasp until the spiritual component is in place. Some of you wonder why you're not happy in marriage and in life. You wonder why you're not content, and it's simple. You're not walking with God. Your relationship to God is not healthy. You're openly disobedient to God. You're ungodly. You're ungrateful. You're as spiritually immature as somebody as a four-year-old in our nursery. And until you repent, until you get your relationship to God right, you are doomed to a life of chronic dissatisfaction. And no spouse on earth can fix that. I offer two biblical examples as proof. The first biblical example is Solomon, writing in the book of Ecclesiastes. This is what he said about all the stuff he had. Ecclesiastes 2, 4 through 10. I also tried finding meaning by building huge homes for myself and by planting beautiful vineyards. I made gardens and parks, filling them with all kinds of fruit trees. I built reservoirs for collecting water to irrigate my flourishing groves. I bought slaves. Both men and women and others were born into my household. I also owned great herds and flocks, more than any of the kings who lived in Jerusalem before me. I collected great sums of silver and gold, the treasure of many kings and provinces. I hired many wonderful singers, both men and women, and had many beautiful concubines. I had everything a man could desire. So I became greater than any of the kings who ruled in Jerusalem before me. And with it all, I remained clear-eyed, and I could evaluate all these things. Anything I wanted, I took. I did not restrain myself from any joy. I even found great pleasure in hard work and additional reward for all my labors. But as I looked at everything I had worked so hard to accomplish, it was so meaningless. It was like chasing the wind. There was really nothing worthwhile anywhere. You see, Solomon basically said, I had it all. But he was like Muhammad Ali, who said at one point in an interview, I had the world in the palm of my hand. I had the world in the palm of my hand, and it wasn't nothing. That's what Solomon said. So I offer Solomon as an example. But also I offered the woman at the well. You remember the woman that the Lord Jesus met at the well in Samaria? And he spoke to her and he basically acknowledged to her that she had had five husbands. And the man that she was living with at that time was not her husband. And he offered her living water. In John chapter 4, God's word says, Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water shall thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life." When the Lord Jesus looked at her, he didn't say, "You haven't found the right husband." When he looked at her, he did not say, "You haven't been successful enough." When he looked at her, he basically said, "Your need is spiritual." Let me ask you, why do professional athletes worth millions get divorced? I mean, why Tiger Woods worth almost $1 billion? Why was he a serial adulterer? Why do you think movie stars like Johnny Depp made $350 million off the Pirates of the Caribbean franchise? $350 million. More than all of us will make together in all of our lifetime. Makes $20 million a picture. Makes $1 million a day. Why can't Johnny Depp find happiness in marriage? What's their problem? The problem is the spiritual component is not in place. Doesn't matter how successful you are, and doesn't matter how humble your state in life is either. Until the spiritual side of our lives is healthy, long-term happiness and contentment, it just ain't gonna happen. So how do you achieve that? How do you achieve spiritual health? Well, you achieve it, first of all, through a relationship to Jesus Christ. Perhaps someone is in here today, and you would say, "I've never placed my faith in Christ. I'm out here. I'm an island unto myself. I'm out here, in a sense, alone in life." Well, until you come to that point and you acknowledge the Lord Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life, that no one comes to the Father but by me." Until you come to that point that you acknowledge that you're a sinner and that you're willing to allow the Lord Jesus to be the boss of your life, and until you're willing to turn your life over to Him, you're just not going to find peace and contentment. It's just not going to happen. But you also must grow spiritually. 1 Peter chapter 2, I think I put that right here. "Therefore, putting aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisy and envy and all slander, like newborn babes, long for the pure milk of the word, that by it you may grow in respect to salvation." Some of you are saved, but you've never really gotten serious about your faith. You rarely pray. Your relationship to God's church is fringe at best. And the church is here to help you grow in your faith through small groups and through opportunities for service and through varied teaching times and through fellowship with God's people. This church exists to help you grow in your faith. In the past 6 or 7 years, just in my own personal Wednesday night Bible studies that I have shared, we've gone through 112 of the Psalms, 112 Psalms. We've been through Paul's letters to Galatians and the Corinthians. We've studied the entire books of Genesis and Malachi and Proverbs. We don't study God's word as literature. We study it to see how it applies to our lives. Brother David does the same thing with the youth, and Jenda and the children's leaders do the same thing with the children. And so if you are not growing in your faith, it's not because food's not out there. You say, "Brother Tommy, I've never just really gotten connected to this church." Well, my goodness, go somewhere and get connected. Now, I would love for you to be connected here. And I would love for you to be involved here. I mean, spiritual food is getting put out every time you turn around here. But if you can't be happy here, my goodness, go somewhere where your soul will be fed, where you will grow in your faith. You see, until you're saved and growing in your faith, your wagon is rolling on square wheels, okay? It's going to be a bumpy ride. You know what? As I thought about this message, I thought, you know, I can name names. I can name you bunches of happily married people here at the First Baptist Church of Meridianville. I can name you couples that have been married 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, 60 years. I can name you, but they're not perfect. They got problems just like everybody else, but they've got the joy of marriage. Why? Because they are not asking their spouse to do for them what only God can do. They're not asking their spouse to fulfill them 100% of the time, all the time, every day. Your spouse can't do that. Only God can do that. You say, well, I'm married. We attend church and we're active here. We're in small groups. We're present at teaching times. We're growing in our faith like everybody else. We're three steps forward, two steps back. But we sort of have the blahs, you might ask me. Are there things that we can do in our marriage today that in our marriage, committed to the Lord, growing in our faith, are there things we can do to increase the happiness factor in our marriage? Several years ago, I read a book by two Christian counselors, Les and Leslie Parrott. They identified seven things a couple can do to encourage happiness in marriage. I'm not going to give you all seven. Go buy their book. It's called Making Happy, okay? You can get it off Amazon.com. If you buy it before October 1st, you won't have to pay 8% tax on it, okay? So just, you know, so go buy the book. But what they say is, they first of all say what I've just told you, what I've just shared with you, what I've just shared with myself. Happiness is a spiritual issue, first and foremost. If you don't have that, you're not going to be happy. But then they talk about seven things, seven marriage boosters. Well, I'm going to give you three of my own. You can go look at their seven. I'm going to give you three biblical marriage boosters that will begin to impact your life today. And they actually mention the first one in their book. It's their first one. It's simply count your blessings. I don't think it would surprise you that the number one on their list was that of count your blessings. In the words of the old song, when upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. I love Psalm 100 where the psalmist said, enter his gates with thanksgiving, go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name, for the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and his faithfulness to each generation. The fact is, your life is never filled with more joy than when you are conscious of your blessings. The Wall Street Journal actually had an article on gratitude, and this is what they wrote about gratitude. Adults who frequently feel gratitude have more energy, more optimism, more social connections, and more happiness than those who do not. They're also less likely to be depressed, envious, or greedy. They earn more money, sleep more soundly, exercise more regularly. Take the words of the Apostle Paul to heart. 1 Thessalonians 5, where the Apostle Paul said, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks. Someone has determined the average person, just like Brother Tommy, the average person complains between 10 and 20 times a day. We complain. We complain from the time we get up till the time we go to bed. It's a habit that we have. One Kansas City pastor read that and challenged his congregation to go 21 days without uttering a complaint. 21 days. He said it took him almost 4 months to go 21 straight days without complaining. Happy couples know the meaning of gratitude. They're specifically grateful for one another. Just the other day, Laura wrote one of our relatives on their 50th birthday. And she titled the note, 50 things we love about you. And so she listed 50 things that we love about this relative of ours. I can remember going to youth camps, and in those youth camps, what we would do, we would get a piece of paper and tape it to our back. Everybody have a piece of paper taped to their back. Some of y'all went to youth camps like that. Tape the piece of paper to your back. Then you go around the room, and everybody writes something on that piece of paper that they appreciate about you. It was incredibly affirming. I would encourage you to spend some time in the coming days categorizing specifically the way that your spouse makes your life better. One of my favorite musicians is now retired Don Williams. Many years ago, he wrote a song to his wife. They've been married 56 years now. Her maiden name was Joy Buker, and now she's Joy Williams, has been for the last 56 years. And the song he wrote to his wife simply goes, "You placed gold on my finger. You brought love like I've never known. You gave life to our children and me a reason to go on. You're my bread when I'm hungry. You're my shelter from troubled winds. You're my anchor in life's ocean. But most of all, you're my best friend. When I need hope and inspiration, you're always strong when I'm tired and weak. I could search the whole world over and you'd still be everything that I need. You're my bread when I'm hungry. You're my shelter from troubled winds. You're my anchor in life's ocean. But most of all, you're my best friend." And I think when I thought of that, I thought Don Williams has sung that poem almost probably every concert that he has performed for the past 45 years, and basically it was nothing more than a poem that told his wife, "I love you and I appreciate you." Sometimes all our marriages need is a revival of gratitude. That's all they need. And I would encourage you over these next days, as I've said, maybe write down 50 ways that your spouse makes your life better. But then secondly, there's a second happiness booster after count your blessings. Cultivate a servant spirit. The Lord Jesus said, "It is not this way among you, but whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your servant." The Lord Jesus basically said, the world says greatness is found in ordering people around. And the Lord Jesus said, the greatest person is the servant. Marriages in which couples serve one another from a mature biblical perspective are the marriages in which happiness is regularly created. I've told you about Gary Chapman, the counselor that's written all those books. He said he and his wife got married, and they immediately despised one another. He had a list of things he thought wives should do. She had a list of things she thought husbands should do. And come to find out, they had not read one another's list and weren't really interested in one another's list. He said that their marriage began to descend into negativity. They were cold to one another. They basically didn't even speak to one another, even though he was in seminary. He said, until the day he realized how selfish he had been, he began to serve his wife, and he said the entire atmosphere of our home changed. He adopted the role of a servant. You see, when each of us goes out of our way to meet the needs of the other voluntarily by choice, we become Christ-like spouses. Instead of focusing on our needs, instead of obsessively focusing upon our own satisfaction, we celebrate our spouse. We give to them. We praise them. We encourage them. We honor them. We respect them. We give grace to them. Why must this be done without focusing upon our own needs? Well, because if you're chronically viewing everything your spouse either does or does not do, if you're chronically, obsessively viewing your spouse only in terms of how it impacts you, you will develop a negative attitude toward your spouse. A spiritual chip will be on your shoulder. That was Gary Chapman's problem. Everything his wife did seemed to remind him of the things that she was not doing for him. But he lost that chip on his shoulder when he began to adopt the role of a servant. He began to treat her with the consideration of Christ. He washed clothes. He folded. He actually washed dishes and folded clothes. He chose to serve her. And servants choose to be givers. Spouses that serve within the home are inevitably happier. I'm going to challenge you for the rest of this day, for the rest of September the 18th, adopt the role of a servant. Just try it. Make your decisions, what you say, what you do, based upon how it will impact your spouse. Think before you say it. Think before you do it. How will this impact the person that I took my vows to? Do you realize it's possible to be pathetically selfish? To be so pathetically selfish that you don't even know how pathetically selfish you are? Cultivate an attitude of service within the home. For once, don't think about yourself. Just give, expecting nothing in return. And when you become that servant spouse, you become beautiful in the eyes of God. Years ago, I read a story about a young nurse who was a student. She was also a Christian. And she was given the responsibility to care for a lady named Eileen. Eileen had an aneurysm. According to the doctors and nurses, she was a vegetable. And according to the doctors and nurses, she knew nothing. She heard nothing. She wasn't even able to feel pain. She was fed through a tube. And Eileen had to be turned and changed twice a shift. And the head nurse took this little student nurse who was a Christian, took her inside the room and said, we basically don't interact with her. She said, this is one of the bad cases, and you just have to sort of emotionally shut yourself down in these cases. You can't get involved. But this young Christian nurse chose to give to the patient who had nothing in return. She actually would sing to her. She talked to her. None of the other nurses talked to her. She talked to her. She encouraged her. She literally brought little gifts into the room and would say, Eileen, I brought this gift for you today. And she would place it in the room. Never a response. Eyes closed. Nothing. Never even a grunt. One day that young Christian nurse was upset. She was supposed to be off on Thanksgiving Day. She got called in and she was in Eileen's room. And she's standing next to the bed and she turns and says to Eileen, she needed somebody to talk to, didn't have much staff on Thanksgiving Day. And so she just turned to Eileen and said, today was my off day, and I don't mind telling you, Eileen, I was in a cruddy mood this morning. I was so angry about having to come in on my off day, on Thanksgiving Day. But I'm glad I'm here. I wouldn't have wanted to have missed seeing you on Thanksgiving Day. Do you know it's Thanksgiving? And then the phone rang off in the distance, and that nurse turned to see if somebody was going to get the phone. When she turned back, Eileen's eyes were open, and huge tears were forming puddles on the mattress there where she lay. You see, Eileen could hear, and Eileen could see. Even though she couldn't respond, even though she couldn't give back, it changed the entire view of the entire staff toward that lady. And the young nurse actually wrote later, it occurred to me that I owe Eileen an awful lot. Except for Eileen, I might never have known what it's like to give myself to someone who can't give back. That kind of attitude that serves, that gives, that encourages without expecting anything in return is the kind of attitude that can change a life and a marriage. Happiness booster number two, cultivate a servant spirit. Happiness booster number three, communicate commitment. Genesis 2:24, for this cause a man shall leave his father and his mother and cleave to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. My brothers and my sisters, we ought to communicate commitment every day, every hour, in every way we can to let our spouse know we are there and we're going to be there. That when we took our vows, we meant it. There ought never be a time, ever, that you cut your spouse with a mention of somebody else. There ought never be a time like that. Years ago, I read the following account from a surgeon and author named Richard Selzer. He said, I stand by a bed where a young woman lies, her face post-operative, her mouth twisted in palsy, a tiny twig of the facial nerve, the one to the muscles in her mouth has been severed. She will be this way from now on. the surgeon had followed with religious fervor the curve of her flesh. I promise you that. Nevertheless, when I did the surgery, I had to cut that nerve. Her young husband is in the room. He stands opposite of the bed, and together they seem to dwell in the evening lamplight, isolated from me, private. Will my mouth always be like this, she asks. Yes, I say, it is because the nerve was cut. She nods and is silent. But the young man smiles and looks at her and says, I like it. I think it's kind of cute. The doctor says, I'll lower my gaze. Even with me there, he bends to kiss the crooked mouth. And I am so close that I can see how he twists his own lips to accommodate her, to show her that their kiss still works. What was that young man telling her? He was telling his wife, in word and deed, I took my marriage vows seriously, and you are mine, and I rejoice over you. I'm going to ask married couples to do something now. Every married couple, get with your spouse right now. Stand up, get with your spouse. We're gonna renew our vows. You're gonna get to kiss them in the service, okay? Amen. Laura, you need to come up here because I've got my stuff up here. Stand up. Find your spouse. Okay, you need to turn and join hands and look at them in the eye. I always tell grooms, do not look at me. You're not marrying me. You're marrying her. Okay, just repeat after me. Y'all say this in unison. That means you say it at the same time to one another, okay? In unison. We share our vows.
We share our vows.
To become one in Christ. With our hearts and our minds. Our souls and our spirits. From this day forward. We pledge our love and trust to one another completely until death only parts us. Okay, now men, I'll start with the ladies. Ladies, put your hand on your husband's ring. Put your hand on your husband's ring and repeat this to him. Look at him in the eye and say, I give this ring as a token of my love for you. This ring is a symbol of my promise that we shall be together in sickness or in health, in poverty or in wealth, forsaking all others for the rest of our days. Okay, men, take your wife's ring, hold it. Look at her and I want y'all to say it louder than they did. That was, okay? Okay. I give this ring as a token of my love for you. This ring is a symbol of my promise that we shall be together in sickness or in health, in poverty or in wealth, forsaking all others for the rest of our days. Now you can kiss them. No. Now you can sit down, hold their hand, because I'm going to play a song that I love by Kathy Mattea. It's called The Battle Hymn of Love. So go ahead and play that song, okay? And listen to the words. You can turn it up.
I will pledge my heart to the love we share through the good and the bad times too. I'll forsake my rest for your happiness. Till my death I will stand by you. With God as my witness, this vow I will make to have and to hold under skies gray or blue, till my death I will stand by you.
Amen. God loves you, and God loves your marriage. He intends for it to be, he does, he intends for it to be a little bit of heaven on earth. Please stand. We're going to have a time of invitation. It's right and appropriate. Perhaps in your life, your next step toward where you need to be is joining this fellowship, and that'd be great. Perhaps your next step is placing your faith.